Happy, what is today?
Tuesday. Happy Tuesday.
Post Labor Day. We are joined with a fantastic guest today. Detroit's
finest. One of the best.
Everyone knows him. Mario Impemba, thank you for joining us. Appreciate it.
Hey, guys. Great to be here. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you for taking the time out of your day. And local guy that we grew up listening to and that we absolutely love the calls. And we definitely miss it. So
So kind of today, we kind of just want to talk about, you know, your time as, you know, calling games for the Tigers and, you know, what you did after that and, you know, kind of before that, you know, everything, just everything. You know, it's a podcast, so we just talk about literally everything, you know, whatever comes to our mind. So you first started off with the Angels, right?
I did.
Okay. So talk to us about that time. You know, what your career was like being a broadcaster at that time, and, you know, walk us through.
Well, yeah, I spent 8 years in the minor leagues calling minor league baseball in, you know, small towns in the Midwest. I was in Davenport, Iowa, Peoria, Illinois. Eventually got to Tucson, Arizona for AAA baseball. And then in 95, I applied for a job with the Angels. They had an opening in Anaheim, and they were the California Angels at that time. And lo and behold, I got the job. I couldn't believe it. I thought, you know, I'd go for it and see at the very least if it would be, you know, a good experience to interview for a big league job, and I ended up getting the job. So that was my start in Major League Baseball in 1995 with the Angels. I spent 7 years there, and then eventually the job opened up here in Detroit. Mm-hmm. And in 2002, I switched from LA to my hometown here in Detroit, and kind of the rest is history, I suppose.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. No, you've had some very famous calls that we've all been a part of. I mean, we all remember Justin Verlander's no hitters. So what, you know, you're kind of picking up back off you. What is your favorite or most memorable call that you made as an announcer? It doesn't have to be with Detroit, but I mean, the bulk of your career was with the Tigers.
Yeah, you know, there are so many over the years. You know, Miguel Cabrera winning a triple crown, Verlander's two no-hitters, you know, the divisional championship clinchers. But the one call that kind of sticks out for me is the J.D. Martinez home run off Chris Sale
when J.D. came too. Up. Yes. Yeah, because when you were sitting in the booth and you were like, man, if he hits one out here, and then like, he literally hits one out, I just like, if I was,
you know, like, I got real lucky there in calling that, because you just had a feel, you know, the crowd was swelling. Everybody's getting excited. JD coming off the DL and his first at bat. Chris Sale is on the mound. It was a big game.
Yeah.
And, you know, I just kind of uttered, if he hits one out here, this place is going to go. And lo and behold, the first pitch he hit went out. And there's obviously a lot of luck involved in that. But, you know, you just had the feeling he was going to do something special there, and he did.
Yeah. I mean, you had – yeah, so you had the triple crown. You had the – the first, okay, so which one was like more, you felt a lot better? Like the Justin Verlander first no-hitter or the second one? Like which
first
one?
The first one. In 07, yeah, without a doubt. I mean, he was, that night, guys, he was throwing about 100 miles an hour in the ninth inning. And, you know, you don't see starters do that. You might see a reliever come in, like an Aroldis Chapman, and come in and throw 101, 102 in the ninth inning. Well, you know, that's one thing, but they have a guy pitch nine innings and still be throwing 100 triple digits, 101, I think he threw in the ninth inning. Mm-hmm. And that was the first Tigers no-hitter that I had called. And so it was special. You know, it was kind of a weird night, because I don't know if you remember, we had all the seagulls on the field that night.
Yes, and they flew out of it. Yeah.
So it was kind of a bizarre night. But, yeah, that to me was more electric. His second no-hitter against the Blue Jays in Toronto, mm-hmm, was a little bit more pedestrian. He wasn't throwing as hard. He didn't have as many strikeouts. He was just pitching at that time. But the 1-07 was just dominant against the Brewers, and that probably was more fun.
Yeah.
One of my favorite Tiger moments, I guess, growing up, my dad and I and my brother, we went to the ALDS clincher against the Yankees, and that was electric because they were a wild card team, 3 years ago. They were the worst team in baseball and had 119 losses, and then within 3 years later, they're going. They went on this magical run with Maglio hitting the walk-off home run in the ALDS, and so that was one of my favorite Tiger moments. But my question to you is, why couldn't the Tigers ever win a World Series with as good as teams as they had?
From a guy who's been around them so much,
I mean, they've had the staff of Cy Youngs. They had Anibal Sanchez with the ERA leader. I mean, Papa Grande was 49 for 49. So What was it that they just couldn't get over that hump, that you saw something that maybe the fans didn't see, or that we saw on paper? We knew the bullpen struggled at times, but what was something that you felt that why couldn't they get over the hump? Why couldn't they win the World Series?
Well, I go back to 2013, and I thought at that time Tigers had the best team in baseball. And, you know, they're rolling to Boston, and they take, you know, game one, and they're on the verge of winning game two, and they would go back to Detroit up 2-0, and then, you know, Benoit hangs one to David Ortiz, a grand slam, yeah. And all of a sudden it's 1-1 instead of 2-0, and that changed that series dramatically. But if I had to point to one thing in terms of the inability to win a World Series, it's what you talked about. It's consistent bullpen work. You know, they did have guys who, you know, as you mentioned, Jose Valverde, 49 straight saves, and they had some good pieces here and there. Phil Koch really did a nice job in 06 coming out of the bullpen.
Yep.
But they never really, as a group, had that consistent effort. And when the chips were down, they couldn't make big pitches. And, you know, and I look back at the 2012 team that probably should have won the World Series against San Francisco. I mean,
yes,
yeah. You had Cabrera and Prince in the middle of your lineup. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
You know, that was another really good team, too, with a very good pitching staff. But for whatever reason, they just could not get over the hump. And that was very disappointing, to be sure.
Yeah. So you after you left the Tigers, you went to call games for the Red Sox, correct?
Correct.
How was Fenway? How was that atmosphere? How was calling games for the Red Sox?
Well, I got to be honest. You know, I grew up watching baseball at Old Tiger Stadium. You guys are probably too young for that, but
just on the edge.
Yeah. You know, I remember going to Old Tiger Stadium as a kid. You know, me and my buddies when I was in high school, we'd jump in the car and we drive down, you know, it didn't matter. It could be a July game and against, you know, Kansas City. It didn't mean anything. It was just fun, man. It was just, there was nothing like Tiger Stadium. And Fenway Park is that same way. It's the old school ballpark. It's, you know, it's the organ music. It's the Green Monster. It's the Green Monster seats. It's, you know, the seat out right field where Ted Williams supposedly had a home run a mile and a half. I mean, there's just certain ballparks that ooze history and character, and Fenway is one of those. And I liken it to Tiger Stadium because Tiger Stadium, I mean, Ty Cobb, you know, used to roam Tiger Stadium, and you know, you get to Fenway and Ted Williams used to roam the outfield there and all the great players they had there. But it was cool, man. It was, you know, you'd walk into Fenway and you're like, yeah, this is kind of the mecca of baseball now, with old Yankee Stadium gone, old Tiger Stadium gone. That and Wrigley, of course, are there too, Fenway and Wrigley. But it was really cool. I mean, the crowds get into it. They didn't play all that well last year. The Red Sox, they underachieved, but still the crowds are really good. And I had a blast. It was fun.
That's nice. That's nice.
The old I'm a big baseball junkie, and the old – I've been to Fenway and had the ability to go, and it looks like a brand-new ballpark when you walk around the concourse. When I was there, I want to say 5 years ago, 6 years ago, and everything was well-kept. Everything looked, you know – brand kind of new, on the newer side, but when you walk into the baseball down into the down to the field to go to your seat or up to your seat, like it felt like old baseball. It felt like old time baseball, and we were sitting right behind the bullpen, and it was cool to see all the old nostalgia of baseball. And I think as a 24-year-old and a lot of young people are starting to lose the baseball enjoyment or the baseball feel. And I never will. I always love baseball, but what do you think needs to change in baseball to bring the younger crowd back? Is it, you know, the 7-inning games? I mean, I'm a traditionalist, and I'm sure you are too. But what has to change to bring a younger crowd back into the game?
Well, first of all, I don't think I've met two guys in their 20s that call themselves traditionalists. That's what comes up on that. Yeah, you know, I think there are a lot of things right now. The game has really kind of strayed from the way it was in the 70s and 80s when I was growing up. I mean, I was watching some old video clips, some old Tigers games on YouTube, and time of the game was like, you know, an hour and 50 minutes or 2 hours and 10 minutes, and that was consistent. That's how quickly they played the games back in the 80s. But I think along the way, players now have become slower at the way they've, you know, every pitch has become an event. You know, right. It's like we had Victor Martinez here in Detroit. you know, he'd step in, take a pitch, he'd step out, he'd walk around, he'd adjust the gloves, he'd adjust, you know, I was just like, dude, get back in the box.
The human rain delay.
It is. And a lot of players are getting like that. It's like, that's why I love Rajay Davis. When Rajay Davis was a Tiger, he would step in the box and he wouldn't step out until he either made an out or struck out or got a base hit or whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's the way I think the game should be played. Now even pitchers will make a pitch, step off the mound, circle, pull up the cap, take a deep breath. You know, it's like, God, let's go.
Yeah, right.
And I think that's part of the problem. If we would just enforce the rules in terms of, you know, they make this rule a couple of years ago. You cannot step out of the box, you know, unless you foul a pitch off. Well, you know, guys are, you know, they take strike one and they walk out of the box. Like, well, what happened to the rule? Are we not following the new rule?
Right.
Why make the rules if you're not going to follow them? You know, pitchers, you're supposed to throw the ball within 12 seconds. Well, that never happens. You know, so I think that's part of the problem. The game has become so slow. The people are fiddling on their phones now, and they'd much rather do that because the action doesn't grab them.
Right.
And the other thing I would say, guys, is that you can't have postseason games starting at 8 or 9 o'clock at night. I mean, you lose the kids. Well, they got school the next day.
We have arguably the two greatest – one or two of the top five players and maybe the best player out on the West Coast in Mike Trout. And then you have Clayton Kershaw. They're both squaring off at 10 o'clock at night.
Yeah, I'm sleeping.
And I want to watch it, but I'll be honest, I'm getting through 5-6 innings and then I'm going to bed because by the time that happens, it's midnight. So – and the younger kids, I think like baseball needs to expand their marketing ability. And Mike Trout's the greatest player in the game, and we're not in 70% of the fans don't get a chance to really sit and watch a game, or 80% don't get to sit and watch what he really is about and the records that he's breaking and how good he's been since he's come into the league. So I definitely, like you said, would like to see them play more East Coast games at the 7 o'clock and get those in primetime games, because us on the East Coast aren't going to get the chance, or the younger generation isn't going to get a chance to watch those guys.
Yeah. Well, I agree with that. And, you know, for so many years, you know, in the NBA, all they ever talked about in the NBA were Michael Jordan, Magic Johnson, and Larry Bird. They marketed the heck out of those guys.
Well,
there were other great players in the NBA that people just didn't know about. It's the same in baseball now. When I was in Boston last year, we had one of the best players in the game, Mookie Betts.
Yeah.
Nobody knew who Mookie Betts was around the country because they didn't market him.
Yep.
You know, you got to market a Mike Trout. You got to market a Mookie Betts. And so that's part of it, too.
Yeah. So I like to look at things in baseball, and you had, like, signature calls and sayings when people made calls. So I looked at back at, like, all your videos, and, like, one thing that you always did when you made a call was – swinging a drive. So, like, I always wanted to ask, like, a broadcaster announcer, like, do you guys plan that, or do you just, like, it just happens naturally? Like, what's his name? Hawk
Harrelson.
Yeah, like, he's like, put it on the board. Like, do you do that? Like, do you plan that?
Yeah, we don't wake up every morning and say, okay, here's how I'm going to call a home run.
Right.
No, let me script it out right here. No, I think. The swing and the drive is not mine.
Okay.
It's, you know, Tom Hamilton in Cleveland used that quite a bit. And I used to listen to Hamilton a lot. You know, when I was a kid, I used to, you know, listen to Harry Carey and, you know, Jack Buck in St. Louis and Mark Colts down in Texas. And I would pick up things from all those guys that I liked. And Ernie, of course, in Detroit, Ernie Harwell, Paul Carey, George Kell. I think those things, you know, when you hear something you like, it kind of sticks in the back of your mind.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, you see a big home run and it jumps from the back of your mind to the front of your mind and then out your mouth. And sometimes you don't plan it.
Yeah, so quick.
The swing and drive thing, I think, was something that I picked up somewhere along the line. It might have been Tom Hamilton because he uses swung on and belted and swung and a drive. I mean, it happens organically, or at least I think it should.
Yeah, that's really cool. I always like that.
It doesn't, though.
Yeah.
I noticed, too, like when we watch – when I watch ESPN and you watch the top 10 players of the highlights when I was growing up, it was a lot of radio broadcasters would get on the video feed. And when it would come to Detroit, you and Rod would always be the guy that would call the home run or would call the great play. And I think everybody in baseball respected, you know, you guys and you just as an announcer, you were here for
17 years.
So
17,
it was – it's crazy to think that I'm 24. So when growing up and just listening, it was in the back of my mind, that's Mario and Rod. And you guys are the best guys in the game. And we, you know, we, we respected you guys growing up and looked up to you. So yeah. When kind of back to baseball is Fernando Tatis is one of the best young players in the game right now. But a couple weeks ago, and I think this is where baseball kind of fails, or that in my eyes is he swung on a 3-0 pitch, hit a home run, and then late in the game hit a grand slam. And the Rangers were upset at that point. And to me, it's kind of like, I'm not sure if you're the same way, but make a better pitch. Don't put yourself in that situation. You guys are professional athletes. And, I mean, what is your take on that? Was the Rangers kind of overstepping boundaries? I know they're like 3-15 since that incident. But
3-0? So we think on a 3-0 pitch.
Are you, you know, is it, do you follow the unwritten rules of baseball? Of, I don't swing on 3-0 or we're up by a big lead. We're kind of taking it easy. Or how do you... Or was the media and the Rangers overreacting in that call or that play?
Well, I'm with you on that. I hate unwritten rules. And okay. When I would do games, Kurt Gibson, Gibby and I would argue all the time because he managed the game, played the game, and certainly I respect that. And I would never say your opinion is wrong. Opinions are what they are. They're just opinions. But I hated unwritten rules. And you have no idea how many times I've seen teams come back from 10 runs down, you know, in the seventh inning. Mm-hmm. So it's my thought that you never have enough runs on the board. And Jim Leland would say that all the time. You never have enough offense. So, no, if you want to lay one in there on 3-0, I'm taking a hack. Look, I'm trying to make money, too. I'm trying to make my career. If you're going to give me a 3-0 fastball, I'm going to take it and I'm going to hit it. You know, the other thing is what if it's a 1-0 game in the eighth inning and the opposing pitcher has a no-hitter? And now you get like a leadoff walk and or some guy tries to bunt his way on with a base hit. You got the third baseman back, and instead of swinging away, a fast guy bunts and lays down a bunt for a base hit. Well, you're not supposed to do that because the guy has no hitter going. Well, I don't like that. I think that you're trying to win the game.
Right.
And B, the no hitter is secondary. You don't want to be no hit, first of all. But that's his problem. If you want to clear your third baseman back, I'm going to take advantage of that and bunt for a base hit. But that is such a no-no in the game. Mm-hmm. And I think that we're starting to change now because the younger players are much more, you know, they just kind of do their thing. They're outgoing. They're pimping home runs. They're pumping their fist after big strikeouts, pitchers are. So the game is changing. So I think some of these unwritten rules are starting to kind of melt away as well.
Yeah, I agree with you on the no-hitter. I think it's more of a, I don't know if I want to say read the room situation, but if you're 1-0, 2-0, close ball game, you're bunting a guy over, I love to see a guy lay one down. And because, like you said, you're competing for your job, your team to win a game. And I don't have the numbers off the top of my head, but how many times has a season come down to where we're one or two games back, and if we just would have played a little small ball here, maybe swung in a 3-0 pitch, we could have maybe
momentum
won. Yeah, yeah. Momentum change, win the game. So right. I think, you know, I know hitters are special. Lucas Giolito threw one earlier this year, and it was super, super cool to see. I know Maeda was close early in the year, and those are exciting baseball things. And if I would rather go to a game and it be a 1-0 Scherzer versus Verlander, and or, you know, not that obviously at the Tigers, but a pitcher's duel, then I guess see, you know, 5-6 home runs. And I know the crowd goes crazy with home runs, but I love the battle and the strategic play of every pitch means something, and I can't make a mistake. So.
I want to get your take on the whole Houston Astros thing. You know, you know what happened in this past offseason or past season. And I know that you spent a lot of time, you know, or around, you know, Verlander and those guys. I mean, like, what were your thoughts on that whole thing?
Well, first of all, I wonder why they did it, because they're good enough to win without cheating.
Right.
I mean, I don't get it. I don't understand it. I mean, you've got guys that are really well respected in the game, like Verlander and Springer and Altuve and all those guys out there in Houston, and, you know, Bregman. They got a great team, and, you know, to be doing stuff like that, I don't get it. I know you want to have a competitive edge. If you have a guy sitting at second base and he's stealing signs from the catcher, that's one thing. That's been part of baseball forever and ever and ever. But when you start elaborate schemes like banging on garbage cans and using video and, you know, and all that kind of stuff, I mean, it's just a byproduct of where the game has gone, because now technology has taken over the game. I mean, guys are sitting in the dugout with iPads looking at, okay, you know, Steve Cishek's coming into the ballgame now. Let me see his last five batters, and they can pull it up on an iPad and show the pinch hitter. I mean, it's It's crazy. So you had to believe stuff like this was going to start to happen when you have so much video available to you at a very quick response time at the dugout. You knew this stuff was going to happen, but yeah, I don't like it. I think it's not cool. And all of a sudden, guys got really quiet. Well, no, we're not cheating until they got busted. And it's just real awkward. And it's just kind of stupid.
I didn't expect it from them.
I didn't either. I was a big Altuve Springer fan. And I can say that's kind of gone down. I still, like him. But it's hard to like somebody who takes advantage and gets an advantage of the game. And I don't know. It sucks to see. And for, Mike Fiers to come out and say that he, they did this, and I respect him. And for people that are going to go at him and say, have, death threats, and they're going to do stuff to him and his family, like, to me, that's over the top. But I don't know how the baseball community, came together and felt like that. But do you feel like those players should have been suspended and not just A.J. Finch and the general manager should have been suspended?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, A.J. Hinch gets, he's caught in it. Alex Cora got caught in it in Boston as well. He was part of the staff. And so, not just saying they did it in Boston last year. I didn't notice anything. But, now they have to fire Cora. You just have to.
Right.
So you can't fire players. I mean, it's the old adage, the head guy's got to go. You can't fire the team. And that's what's happened.
It was like Beltran got manage the Mets, and then all of a sudden, before that even happened, he gets canned as a manager of the Mets. Right. So,
it's a big mess
for sure.
So going back to Tigers real quick, who would you say your top five Detroit Tigers were that like you saw you watched played like you hands down best players to see come through the Tigers organization?
In my 17 years, I had to think about that, but certainly number one would be Miguel.
Okay.
And 1A would be, Verlander. I look at a guy like Joel Zamaya, and I just think about what he could have been had he not gotten injured.
Played guitar.
But those two guys are at the top of my list. I mean, we could go down the list. I mean, we had Prince, and we had Pudge, and we had Fielder. I'd probably put Pudge 3, and I have to think about the other two. We had Sheffield here too. So I mean, there are a lot of really great players that came through here in the mid-2000s, when Illich started spending money. Mago certainly on that list, so put him at 4, and maybe
Granderson,
maybe Sheffield 5
for sure.
Granderson's on there too. Yeah, I mean, you can't,
it's tough. Yeah,
I don't think you can do 5.
Okay, I had to throw a number out there, but I knew 5 was because that 2000s time, it was like, do you ever think the Tigers will get back to that 2000s time of?
Yep.
You think so?
Yep, I really do. I think that the game goes in cycles, and I think that eventually they will get there. And the reason I say that is because all you have to do is kind of follow the blueprint that the Tigers had in 06. I mean, they had some young guys coming up. They had the Verlanders and Zamayas coming up. They had Curtis Granderson coming up. You get that core, and then you start to augment, which is what they did. And they brought in Pudge. They brought in Maglio. They brought in Kenny Rogers, on and on and on. And so I think right now the Tigers, last I saw, their minor league system was ranked 2nd in Major League Baseball. I mean, that's a huge jump. I mean, they were in the deep 20s just a couple of years ago. Mm-hmm. So, you got Matt Manning, you got Scooball, you got, Mize, you've got a lot of guys in the minor leagues. You got Riley now coming up, you got Torkelson. I think they're going to have a good young core in a couple of years. Now, the question is, will they be able to keep them all together once they get really good at the major league level? Because that's when you really have to start spending money. And then they're going to have to augment by going after free agents. So, yeah, I think they'll get there because they have a good, solid young core. And as long as ownership says, all right, let's go for it, like Mike Elch did. I don't think we appreciate Mike Elch enough. I mean, he opened up the pocketbooks, man. He went for it. He didn't get it, but he went for it, and that's all you can ask.
For sure. When a non-Tiger player that you've seen, that you non-Tiger or, let's say, Mike Trout, who do you think is the most, like, an underappreciated player in the game, not necessarily underrated, but underappreciated guy.
Kind of goes unnoticed.
Like, to me, Nolan Arenado is arguably, to me, one of the best defenders and best hitters in the game, but because he plays in Colorado on the West Coast, he doesn't get to see. So Nolan Arenado's mine, but if you had to pick a guy that you feel is undervalued because baseball hasn't marketed him well enough or in the right situations? Who do you think is kind of that falls up there with Mike Trout and Clayton Kershaw, Justin Verlander type players?
Yeah. Arenado is a good pick. I didn't think about him. He's a really good pick. I would still go back to the guy I mentioned a couple of minutes ago, Mookie Betts. And Mookie didn't have the greatest year last year, but I saw enough of Mookie to realize how much of a great player he is. And, you know, he's also a really good dude too. I mean, Mookie's one of the nicest guys you'll be around. And obviously that doesn't mean much as far as grading a guy as a player, but he can do it all. And he's a big time player that steps up in big spots. I think the Dodgers are really going to, you know, be pleased with the fact that he's going to be there now for the next 2 years, but he's one guy that again, Major League Baseball should be marketing, and I don't know why they don't, but he's probably at the top of my list.
So if there was in a magical world out there, if there was a team that was like they had open spots right now, and they were like, yep, you can pick that team to go call games for, who would it be? Like if they're like, yep, you got a spot. Like if you called them and they're like, yep, you're there.
That's a real good one. You know, people would probably think I would say the Yankees, but that's farthest from the truth.
I thought you would say the Yankees.
I was thinking Yankees. I was actually going to say Yankees.
Yeah, it would take a whole lot of money for me to go to the Yankees. They're not going to do it. So I would probably say somewhere in the West Coast, because when I broadcasted for the Angels, I really learned to love the West Coast. Mm. And you know, there's some great towns out there, San Francisco, San Diego, Anaheim, L.A. I would probably say the Angels because they're the team that gave me my first chance to broadcast in the big leagues. Mm-hmm. And the only reason I left the Angels was to come back home to Detroit,
right?
Because it's my hometown. But if I got to pick a landing spot, it would be the Angels. I mean, it's a great ballpark. You're kind of in the shadow of the Dodgers over there, and that's something I had to deal with when I was out there. You know, Vin Scully was still broadcasting for the Dodgers when I was doing Angels games, and yeah, nobody knew who I was because, you know, Vin has such a huge shadow,
right.
And deservedly so. But I'd probably go with the Angels, maybe San Diego. San Diego is a great town. You know, I'm at the point in my life now where I'm, you know, wins and losses don't really matter to me. I want to be like a cool town, you know.
Better weather than Michigan. Yeah, it's raining outside.
Yeah, way better than Michigan.
Exactly. So I'd probably go somewhere on the West Coast. Probably the
Angels.
Awesome.
Nice. Yeah. So do you ever still talk to like Dan Dickerson or like Jim Price or any of those guys for the Tigers on the radio?
Yeah, Dan and I stay in touch quite a bit. And Dan's a really good guy. He and I, you know, you kind of form relationships with certain announcers around the league. Mm-hmm. You know, Dan and I would meet literally before every game. I'd walk into his booth before we'd walk down to the manager's office and get involved in the manager's scrum with the reporters. But Dan and I would sit there and talk for probably 20 minutes. Hey, what are you seeing? What do you think about this? Mm-hmm. Did you hear my call last night? I think I blew that call. You know, I said, nah, I've done that millions of times. You know, we kind of commiserate with each other.
Well, that's cool.
We became pretty tight.
So you guys you blew that call. Like, I messed that call up. That's actually pretty cool.
Well, yeah, it is. Well, you know, I remember a lot of times during day games, people have no idea how difficult it is to call baseball games at Comerica during the day, mm-hmm. because you can't see the ball. You literally can't see the ball. There's so much glare coming off the seats, or I don't know where it's from, but you even lose ground balls in the sunlight. I mean, it's just so bizarre. So we would, you know, I'd walk in Dan's booth and like, man, I missed that home run in the eighth inning last night. I never saw him. Dan go, I didn't see it either. And it makes me feel bad. You know, it's like, okay, he screwed it up too. So, you know, I'm good.
So like walk me through a day, like as a guy like you, like, so like from you wake up in the morning and you have a 7 o'clock pitch for the Tigers. What, how are you preparing? What are you doing? You know, are you meeting with Dan? Like, are you meeting with other announcers? Like, how does that work?
Yeah, well, TV is much different than radio. Okay. And in radio, you kind of do your own thing. You know, you show up to the ballpark when you want. You don't really have to go anywhere. You just show up, make sure you're on the field in the clubhouse getting your work done, and, you know, be at the mic at 7 o'clock. TV is a lot different. TV would be I'd wake up in the morning, probably around 9 o'clock, 8:39, depending on how late the game went the night before. And then at 10 o'clock, we had these – god-awful conference calls where we'd have our executive producer, our director, our font coordinator, our replay guys, like everybody in the world would be on these conference calls. And we all had to talk about what we wanted to talk about that night. And, you know, when you're doing the Kansas City Royals, you know, 19 times a year and it's September and you got nothing more to say about the Royals. I mean, these conference calls were ridiculous.
Yeah, like what
the... But we had to do them anyway.
Right.
So we do the dumb conference calls. And then I would probably tool around on the internet for an hour or so, maybe work out, have some lunch. And I'd get to the ballpark probably around 3:15. And around 4-ish, I'd cruise in Dan's booth and we'd talk for a little bit and go down the field and we're off and running.
Nice.
Awesome. So kind of I was reading up, and when you came back to Detroit, was how different, weird, you know, emotional, was it just... it just didn't feel right. How did it? What was your take when you had to walk through and go to the opposing team's booth or announcer's booth instead of coming in through Comerica Park like you normally would, go see everybody? How different, or how did you feel, or what was your emotion going through your mind when that happened, when you came back to Detroit with Boston?
Well, I'll be back up to spring training, because the first spring training game I did, ironically, for the Red Sox was against the Tigers in Lakers. So how bizarre is that?
For sure.
So I walk into Joker Marshall Stadium and I walk right into the Fox Sports Detroit booth, and I thought, oh my God, okay, yeah, I don't belong here anymore. So I had to go a booth over. But that was weird. We had a series here in Detroit that was led up to the All-Star break that I did for the Red Sox. And there are so many things that made it weird. Little things like you can't park in the Comerica parking structure anymore. Now you got to go across Woodward and park in that structure,
right,
and walk to the stadium. And yeah, it was weird, but you know, the cool thing, guys, was, you know, the first day I came back, one of the first people to walk in the booth and welcome me back was Al Kaline.
Awesome.
And
wow.
That, you know, you're sitting there going, holy cow, Al Kaline just walked in and said, hey, welcome back. And he chatted, you know, then Leland walked in, La Russa walked in. And it was really kind of cool. But it was bizarre at the same time. I felt kind of sad,
for sure,
because I'd been there for 17 years, and you know, the Tigers were part of my life growing up, and things happen, and you know, you move on with life. But it was definitely strange. But you know, once 7 o'clock rolls around, or 1 o'clock for a day game, man, you're doing the game. You're not
right.
thinking about anything but doing the game.
Yeah, for sure.
And so that's what I did.
Yeah, that's cool.
My biggest question is, I've had a lot of beef with Rob Manfred on the show.
Yeah,
and
he hates Rob Manfred.
I can't stand I just feel that he's not the right guy for baseball as right now. Some of the rules, a 3-batter minimum, I know that stuff is, I'm assuming, is voted on and taken in front of a panel of executives and voted on. But to me, I feel like the situations that have been presented to him hasn't handled the right way. And I know a lot of players, and I see on Twitter, I know Trevor Bauer's a big, they're not friends, we'll put it like that, but do you think Rob Manfred's the right guy for baseball? I don't know if you can answer that question, but if do you think he's the right guy, or do we need to look for somebody else? I will sign the petition, and I'm looking for somebody else. Not that Bud Selig was very old school, but I'm not a fan of the new wave, or the new school wave that Rob Manfred's trying to implement.
Well, first of all, I've often wondered why the commissioner of baseball is affiliated with ownership. You
right.
know, it should be an impartial third party, you know, that will look at the players and owners, you know, from an objective view. You can't have that when, you know, you've got a commissioner that's pretty much affiliated with ownership. I mean, it's kind of a bizarre setup to me, and always has been. In terms of Rob Manfred, I've only talked to him a couple of times. We had him on the air once with us, and I would see him at our Fox meetings. Every February, we'd have Fox meetings out in L.A., and Rob would come and speak. And to your point, all of these changes that are being made, they've done extensive research on this, and he would present the numbers as to why they're doing certain things based on the research and the numbers that they had. So I would respect that. Okay, you're doing your research. Your research is telling you to do certain things with the game. Fine. It goes beyond that, though. So I don't know. It's a tough job. I think Rob is a great guy. I think he's a very intelligent guy. I don't know that he's the right guy for the job. I think he's had an opportunity to move this game forward, and is kind of spinning his wheels right now. You know, the COVID certainly hasn't helped him. You know, it basically shut down baseball. And, you know, the way the whole thing was handled with the Players Association, you know, they settled on 60 games. And, you know, the back and forth in the media was just – it wasn't good. And so I think people are just kind of getting tired of him. And but then again, I don't know too many commissioners that anybody really loves universally.
Right. You know, I mean, everybody has a beef with Roger Goodell, Gary Bettman. I mean, Adam Silver – I think a lot of people like Adam Silver, but there still are the haters out there of Adam Silver. So, sure. I don't know the right guy. I'm certainly not the right guy for that job. But
maybe Mario is.
Maybe you are. I think you should go be commissioner. Yeah, I think you should be. But no, I just some of the things, like baseball to me is there. You can play it 21 innings if it goes, or you can play it 9 innings if it goes. And I always liked just. There's no time limit to baseball. There's no – we got to hurry up, get somewhere, and make the pitch. It's all based on the flow of the game. And like you said, games could go from an hour and 50 minutes to 4 hours and 30 minutes. And yeah, you're going to lose people at the four-hour mark. But, football, you know, they're at a time limit. They go 15-minute quarters, same with basketball, 12-minute quarters. I think the cool thing about baseball is there's no time limit. There's no rush to have – you know, I get to understand the 7-inning doubleheaders here, but the runners on second. And to me, I like the old style of let's just play until there's a winner. We don't have to have any, to me, gimmicks in the game. We can't have, you know, we have 6 mound visits per game and we have 3 batter minimums, which I can't stand because some guy comes in for a one out and that's his job. And he gets that guy, a lefty specialist. And not that you're going to lose jobs from people because in certain situations, you're still going to be able to get them out of there after one out with the inning ending. But to me, I want baseball to go back to where it was. But I do think there needs to be some modernization. And I don't know what that is, but it's frustrating to see that some of the things that we enjoy, we don't get to see. Or we're scaling it back to accommodate for other people, to the younger crowd. And I know we need to, but I don't know. What are your thoughts on that? Like, I mean, baseball is, where has it been? Where does it need to go to get more fans?
Well, I was asked this very question a couple of days ago on a different interview I did. And I, you know, I'm with you on the 7-inning doubleheaders. That's basically a function of COVID, you know, but when you're starting to talk about pitch clocks and 3 batter minimums and, you know, the phantom play at second base is gone now. And, you know, the catchers, they're protecting the catchers a lot and at home plate, you know, in the sliding lane and all that stuff. I get it. The game's got to evolve, but I'm with you. I don't, you know, Jim Leland used to say, you know, look, when you go to a movie, if the movie's 3 hours long, you know, and it's a good movie, you stick around for 3 hours,
right,
you know? And so you've got the option of, if it's a slow, bad game, or your team is down 10 runs in the fourth inning, to go home, you go home. I don't like to see the basics of the game changed. I don't like to see the fiber of the game change. And I think that's what we're starting to do. I mean, the pitch clock and the automated umpires, I mean, the automated strike zone, I mean, come on. Yes. Now. I mean, it just, holy cow. I mean, Joe West, for as much as you hate the guy, sometimes he's just really cool for the game.
Right.
Country Joe West.
Yep.
Yeah. Kind of a villain, you know, and everybody loves that about baseball. They're like in the 70s and 80s, man, you had villains and you had heroes and, you know, now the game is changed so much. I get it. It's got to change. There has to be an evolution of the game, but let's not change its core. And I think that's a path we're heading down, and I'm not really a fan of that.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, thank you for taking your time today and, like, you know, talking with us. We really appreciate it. I think everybody in Detroit truly misses, like, having, you know, you call some games. And if I could have, like, a throwback Thursday, you know, maybe, like, have, like, you, like, call a game, I would be down for that. I guess I'll just have to contact the producer, you know, put in my 2 cents. I don't know if that matters or not, but, hey.
My last thing is, does Barry Bonds belong in the Hall of Fame?
Ooh, yeah.
With the steroid? Oh, I know it's a tough question.
On the spot questions.
It really is, but, you know, I'm of the belief that, you know, there are plenty of guys that bent the rules, you know, maybe not steroid, but, you know, I mean, I've seen guys use amphetamines and they're in the Hall of Fame. So where do you draw the line? He is perhaps the greatest player of his era. So My initial answer is yes. But if you're going to put him in, you better put Clemens, McGuire, and the rest of those guys in there.
Pete Rose? You
know, and I was going to get to Pete Rose. I really think Pete Rose belongs to the Hall of Fame. I understand what he did was not right, but he did not bet against his team. He bet for his team. You know, time has a way of washing away a lot of impurities. If you had asked me 10 years ago, 15 years ago, does Pete Rose belong in the Hall of Fame? No. No way. Don't stay in the game like that. Or Barry Bonds, no. Get him out of there. But, yeah, I think if you're going to be fair based on what they've done, Barry probably would have been a Hall of Famer anyway. So
for sure. He stole. Nobody knows he stole 500 bases, over 500 exactly. bases.
Exactly.
So, yeah. No, awesome. No, yeah. I appreciate
it. Thank you again for stopping by. Appreciate it. Hopefully, you know, if you ever want to come back, and we're welcome to come back. We love talking baseball, sports, whatever. So appreciate you.
Hey, guys, call me anytime. I appreciate it. Thanks so much.
Yeah, no problem. Thanks, stay on with us. We got a question to ask you.
Right after.
Follow us at Fully Loaded PC from myself, Rod, the legend, Mario Impemba, Rod. We are out.